that's now abandoned next to the interstate as you're driving into town. It's a building with a big tower that used to have her name on it and isn't there, and now it's got spray paint all over it. That building got surrounded by water on the day after Katrina hit, as you know, the same time frame that a day later than most of the areas closer to the lake got flooded. And we ended up having to evacuate. So I had been covering stuff out of the building until, you know, our publisher basically came around like at 8 o'clock in the morning and said, get in the trucks now. And we literally everybody else picked up their suitcases because we had been staying there as a shelter. I picked up my bag and my computer, and I was the bright one. then we, you know, then we were refugees, and some of our staff went north to Baton Rouge. They were able to get up and out, and others and me went to Houma, to the southwest. I was listening to WWL radio on the way, and public officials were coming on every 2 seconds and telling what was going on, and I'm typing all this on my computer in the back of a panel truck, like a newspaper delivery truck. So I'm listening, and when we got to Houma, I had a story written and put it up on the web. And I spent the rest of that night, day and night, taking other reporters' stories and by phone from where they were in New Orleans when they could find a phone that worked, and putting them online as we created a newspaper out of nothing in a PDF document, a 8-page newspaper in the first
days.
And it was 3 days before we were able to get a print edition or a paper printed at the Houma Courier. Our newspaper was surrounded by water and we had no power, and there was nobody there anymore because we'd all evacuated. We didn't get back into the building until October. So I spent the night in Houma and then got back on a truck and went to Baton Rouge, where part of our staff had gone to Radio Shack and everywhere else,
war room it,
and bought every single damn computer they could possibly find and brought them all back to a space that they were creating that would become our newsroom for a couple months. We, on the other hand, went to Louisiana State University, where they had arranged to have access, use of the student, the LSU Manship School of Journalism's student lab with their computers. And so we used that for the first couple of days. And then we moved into this space that they had rented in town and set that up. My reporting was on the bigger issues involving the environment and what was going on as a result of the storm. And then very quickly moved into the levee system. And I ended up covering why the levees failed and how they needed to be built as they moved back. And that became, you know, the rest of my career.
and generated a lot of support in the community, the fact that these guys kept reporting and
oh, yeah,
telling the stories and all that stuff.
We we like to point out that our trucks full of newspapers on that third day got back in before the Army got there. The Army didn't get there until Thursday. We were on the ground on Wednesday. And, you know, which I still...
The pen is mightier than the sword has.
No, well, it was because they had to cut their way out of Mississippi. They had put themselves up just north of Hattiesburg. And these pine trees that fell across the interstate all the way up and down. You know, that storm went right up towards them. And so they literally had to cut their way out to get their trucks and stuff here, as opposed to, you know, why don't you just go by helicopter from Fort Hood? You can do the same thing. It's farther, but you got a hell of a lot of troops there. You could have done the same thing, but neither here nor there. I don't want to.